Chanti Deva Sunvantam Naswapnaya Sprayanti. So I'll be talking about this typical aspect, but I'll be coming to it, you know, because I just want to build my story where some part of it Ganeshwar has already taken care of. So we will go about it. Yes, so this is the thing I'll be sharing you with you, like about human origin, evolution, a bit basics of, so that, you know, like we can catch up later. And then finally coming to the typical question that Aryan envision.
Yeah.
So this one is, say, this one is me. I have two parents, and then they have their parents, and if we step back this way, around some 40 generations, we all will be having this many ancestors, if we take each individual as individual. But we all know that that's not the case. That means you all share common ancestors. So I'm just trying to build my story with the DNA. Okay. So you know, there are two hypotheses, genetics perspective. So whenever we talk about, one is multi-regional hypothesis and another is out of Africa hypothesis. What we see here is, if you see the purple line, it tells about other ancestral human lineages. This typical blue line here, this blue line, these blue lines are other hominid. Like, so this multi-regional hypothesis says that all different, you know, ancestral hominid, jinko we all are presently, we all are being called modern humans, basically, if we go with the genetics perspectives. So all other hominids mean other human-like species. Multi-regional says that they originated in, like our ancestors had common ancestors in Africa, they migrated to different regions, but these had, you know, overlap of exchange of genetic material. The South of Africa specifically says that only these modern humans, they migrated out of Africa, they may have some, you know, like exchange in between. Likewise, we know it's like recently Neanderthal man, Denisovians, these are the common, you know, like other lineages talk about. So this out of Africa hypothesis at the moment is, you know, like it's becoming very strong based on other evidences, different evidences coming together. But still, you know, like still arguments are in place with like with other field of paleontologists and all that, that we are yet to, you know, be in that phase. But we'll be taking this multi-regional hypothesis because what we have is whatever prior data we have to go with that. But it doesn't mean this is one thing about science is, scientists, it's like there is nothing fixed. Science is not fixed. It keeps on changing. Its only thing is you should have, you know, like in you that you accept it. Okay, change is the part of science. There would be many of these things, probably me and Ganeshwar won't be agreeing, but there is one thing for sure we all agree to, so I'll be discussing that. There were things which probably we won't be agreeing on. To begin with, have an idea, like everyone, like I know everyone has an idea about it, that our ancestors originated in Africa some 1 million years ago, they migrated to different regions, and like this was the scenario, I have taken it from 2003. Like things were fine, like you know what I'm saying, like it was going all fine. Then there were some, I feel like maybe it's a strategic way of bringing in things, different perspective, the Aryan invasion story coming back into picture and all that. I'll come to about it later on. Just to have an idea about, like, because we have here people from different backgrounds, just the benefit of everyone, I'll just try to put, like, how do we simply bring in genetics all of a sudden to understand, you know, like these different perspectives about that. Another thing is we have to mind it that when we talk about, like, whatever data we present, like genetic scientists, we talk about few numbers. Say, okay, this population X, I have 100 samples. Population Y, we have 20 samples, you know. But as such, it goes by population genetics. That doesn't represent overall the whole population. It's our assumption that our sampling is perfect. We have done random sampling. That means different parameters are being taken care of. So whatever samples we have studied, those samples represent overall structure of the population. That sample represents everything, or means every human we could study from that particular region. Why I'm putting emphasis on it? Like taking into consideration size of the Indian population. we all know that, I think we are the second, biggest population. Along with it, so diverse population, huge number of groups we have, different ethnic groups. So each and every sample from every population, probably no one would be able to collect. But I think key is collecting as diverse as population, as diverse samples as we could, so that we can really have an overall picture. So that is one important point. I'll come to it again later on. So as we know that DNA is the genetic material we inherit from, and there are two type of variations. I'll just rush through very fast. One is somatic. That means a change in DNA that is restricted to, say, if there is a change in my DNA, but that is restricted to me itself. But when the change is in my germline, so that means I'll be inheriting it to the next generation. So then it will be inherited to the next generation. So for typical study, for this type of study, we target the germline variations, not the somatic variations. So because somatic variations restrict to an individual itself. Two main components, phylogenetics, were earlier studies were primarily based on these, Y chromosome and mitochondria. Why those were like this? Because Ganesh already explained that Y is inherited in father to son fashion, and mitochondria goes from mother to child. Fine. So that means one good thing about this mitochondria and Y is linear. That means there is a linear transmission from parents to their kids, likewise. At the same time, there could be some biases. Why there could be some biases? Because just again, the thing is, what we are trying to do now is we're trying to pick few samples, study those samples, and we want to interpret what has happened long back in time. So that means there is a gap, there is a continuity gap. So these markers usually, many of the times, don't take care of that. As Ganesh rightly added then, that autosomal markers are there when we want to look for the continuity, or we want to look for recent, admixture events, or recent correlation between different populations. But when we want to trace back longer lineages in timeline, usually we go with Y chromosomal and mitochondrial markers. I just try to explain here is how is it? Say once a variation has occurred, then another variation comes in, then another variation comes in. What we are presently doing is we are studying this thing. We don't know when this all has happened in the past, or when all these things have happened. But what we try to do while studying these variations, we try to go back, looking back that how these variations are related, and we look for that particular, here we say, this is our most common ancestor. This is the phylogenetic tree of the male phylogenetic tree. Labeling, as and Dr. Bakshi has already explained, we call them by lineages, or we call them haplogroups. But each haplogroup or its subgroup is actually represented by a variation, a DNA variation. And same thing is with mitochondrial. Okay, this is just frequency distribution. Or frequency distribution means, say, we collected some samples from different regions. This is a published source. I'm sorry, I think it is buried under that because I canceled the animation and the source is buried under this. What does it show? That distribution of groups, this typical lineage or these groups in different regions of the world. This graph is showing that. And this is typical different paternal lineages across the world. And likewise, this is different groups, maternal groups in different regions of the world. So I'll just come to what I have done in 2009. I'll talk about what were the gaps then, what I'm trying to do now, and what were the inferences then, where I was lacking, and what the newer data probably is going to fill that gap. So idea was, what was at that point of time, that some paper like Cordock's paper was there, and then there were few, which were, there is another one, actually I'm forgetting at the moment, that specifically said that this casteism in India, it came from Central Asia, or these Aryans invaded and probably they built up this caste system over here, assigning these typical Aryans or these Indo-European migrants, assigning them higher castes in Indian system. So based on the resources I had at that time, what I tried to do is I simply tried to pull out samples from in our this hierarchical system, the caste from the same geographical location, the higher caste, as well as a tribal, because as per them, the tribals from the regions were assigned the lowest, you know, in that hierarchical system. If that would have been the case, and then at the same time, it had been already like linked to that R1A is, and R1A is actually an Aryan group. So what was my hypothesis over here is like, if that is the case, probably we should be seeing the restriction of R1A in Brahmins itself, and probably we won't be able to see that in other these tribes or other like groups which were assigned so-called you know, lower reputation in that society. So these were different samples from the region. Along with that, I was able to pull out information which was already published from some 3,000 samples from like in different time points. So just cut through, I studied that some 55 markers at that time, Y-SNP markers. See, again, one I think I would like to share is, what thing about the phylogenetics is, markers keep on adding. Over the period of time, markers keep on adding. More data you have, more markers are there. As new, like, because new methodologies are available, higher resolution is there. So at that point of time, this these number of markers were able to resolve me to the level of like different lineages of R. So based on those markers, we try to look into what is the distribution of these groups, these haplogroups, that means different lineages in different individuals, belonging, not individuals, rather different population groups. So as you could see, except for like a few groups which may appear to be restricted to particular population groups, major of the haplogroups were distributed across the you know, like population groups. And specifically talking about R, it was almost present in all of the, you know, population groups we have studied. There were some indications, some, you know, like frequencies of this group in higher in few of the population groups, but overall it was distributed irrespective of caste, irrespective of, you know, like social status it belongs to. The distribution was of similar kind. Mitochondria, as Ganesh already told, it's you know, uniform across different groups. So I'll be, you know, because question was associated with that R, and then typically male inheritance or male lineages, so I'll be restricting myself to R. When we try to distribute again this Y haplogroup data region wise, again there were few regional differences were there, but again most of the groups were distributed uniformly. Specifically this R1A, you know, appeared in all those groups which were from different regions. Looking at the phylogenetic tree, all those individuals like which were from different regions, population groups, what it appeared, and then based on the YSTR data, I missed that. I'll come to it. YSTRs are relatively repeat regions and they are more diverse. So that's why when we try to study lineages, but when you want to study, you know, like differences or similarities within the group itself, then you look for more diverse markers, and YSTRs are those markers. So those markers indicated that Indian population groups are relatively, they form a closer group as compared to any other population group. This is again a plot, I'm sorry it's not that clear, but this typical cluster, you know, like where this plot shows different population groups from the world, this typical cluster is of all the Indian population groups irrespective of their caste. That means here we had collected again coming back Brahmins and you know, like SC or tribals from the same region. So I'll try to emphasize on this one. Ganeshwar has already shown this. I'll just try to, he has more markers, he has worked with more markers at the time. I had worked out it with those four YSTRs. I'll come to it. But what we could see by now is all these groups were sharing similar Y chromosomal, that R1 typical lineage, R1A typical lineage. Why R1A1? R1A means, as I told you, more markers keep on adding, lineages name keep changing. Presently, which was commonly called R1A, I think by recent nomenclature it should be R1A1A something, because it keeps on changing. So confusion occurs with the common people, like in a common population, confusion occurs because nomenclature means giving name. So it's not fixed name, like it changes. More markers come in, it will again shift. So presently maybe which is R1A1A, maybe in due course of time it may become R1A1A1A. So but this typical R1A, what we do try to do recently is we try to add marker along, like Ganesher was telling M780, Ganesher, if I'm right, 780. So probably R1A earlier at that time was by marker M117, and presently it is by M417, if I am right. So it keeps on changing. Anyway, but what I wanted to show here, now I'll come to these two typical pictures, and probably these may interest you. At that time, markers we could have, markers means it is a typical position on DNA to which we could resolve. That means diversity we could look into. That was up to M117 at that time. Single nucleotide polymorphisms or single base pair variations on the basis of which we assign lineage to a group, that restricted itself to M117. So that means at the time we couldn't resolve it further using markers. Now we have additional markers, I'll come to that. But at that time, what we could have added, we added were YSTR markers. That means extra variation within that group itself. So if you see, now I'll try to explain what is over here. This is a global map, and if this is India over here, and each dot is like, it represents samples we collected as well as samples we could collect from literature at that time. You will notice, and this graph up here, it is showing the frequency. Frequency means proportion from that typical sample, that how much samples belong to a particular group. So you will note that if we can compare that frequency goes from 0 to 1. So 1 is the highest, 0 is the lowest. And accordingly, if you see the shade, 0 is whiter portion is the lightest, and this darker portion is in the highest frequency. So you could see that these are the regions probably where the frequency of that typical haplogroup R1A, which is assigned to Aryans, is higher. This is European region, central region, and then typically this Indian region. Again, the frequency could of a haplogroup in a region could be due to two reasons. One is the typical population effect, which is called founder effect. Means founder effect is population. There is another region. There is a very diverse population. Different groups are there. Only few people from that population move to another place, and then they started expanding over there. So what will happen? Not all the haplogroups, not all the different lineages, only that lineage will start to expand in this region, fine? And other way is a particular group is located in a region, catastrophic events, different situations have happened, and it has removed all the diversity from that region, and only very few individuals are restricted to that region, and due course of time maybe they expanded. So this could be. If you want to see what is represented here, these circles, these big circles, these are showing YSTRs. That means repeat regions, on the basis of repeat regions, that means how much similar, so bigger the circle is, that means similar type of genetic content it is having. Means if you see this biggest circle, that means this proportion is having similar type of genetic content, fine? And what we see here is, that means different individuals but diverse. So each individual is having a different type of background, different genetic content. Means diversity is high in this, if it falls something like this, diversity is very high, and if we see this type of structure, that means frequency is high but diversity is not high. So what we could see here is like Indian, why these R1A, M17 groups, these were highly diverse, but the European and Central Asians were relatively, frequency is relatively high, but diversity is relatively less. So, so that means again, if you plot based on diversity, you could see that probably R1A, this group has originated somewhere in this region, the Indian subcontinent, I'll put it this way. So this was the age estimates at that time based on YSTR markers. Again, as I told you that in science there is nothing fixed. For quite longer period of time, this has been assumed, and I think many of the groups are still using this YSTR based estimations. But as Janeshwar told, that recent idea is that probably YSTR based age estimations are not good. So probably, I believe it's because the principle doesn't change, probably it's need is recalibrating. So what we do here is like, how do we calculate age using DNA? Simply, we pick a strand of DNA, or that means a range of DNA. We look for how many variations have happened in that particular region over a point of period of time. I'll just try to put it this way. Say if we pick a 100 nucleotide region or 100 base region, and in one region, say one individual, there are two mutations, yeah, two changes. Okay, and if we assign that one change takes place every 10,000 years. So what does it mean? That this individual having two variations means the age of that, group is 20,000 years. Likewise, if another individual has say five variations in that particular region, so the age becomes 50,000. So different methodologies have different ways of age estimations, but this is what we do when we do age estimations using DNA. So what we require here is probably because I assume the way we calibrated it has changed. So earlier maybe that was say 15,000 or 60,000 years ago. Maybe it requires recalculation, and probably we'll come with, not we, I mean, it's like overall, globally. So I would like to share another interesting perspective, and usually when we see it with the European or you're with that mindset, we don't do this often actually. What we wanted to do here was, okay, without biasing my, my opinion, without biasing it, I try to test for three ideas. What say EU stands here is for one group, CA stands for another one, and IB stands for another one. EU is from Eurasia, CA is for Central Asia, I is from India. So what I wanted to see here is, what if I take these markers and look for which one is the parental population for which group. So I tried different models, and here is the proportion, like it comes up, this is admixture analysis, and it gives you proportion that which group contributes to which proportion. I'll come to this one later on. I hope this is clear over here, but this is, it shows you the I'll put it as like percentage. Say this is one population, this is another population, and that this is, so in this scenario, what does it show? It show that Central Asians have contribution 97%. It is typical for R1A, I'm not talking about any other group, just R1A. So 97% of the diversity in the Central Asian population is contributed by Indians, 3% is contributed by Europeans. In this model, if we put it as another way around, like say Europeans, so again you will see that Indians have contribution of I think it's almost 99 or 98 point some percent, and then 0 point some percent is from Central Asians. And this one, and when we do apply this model, these all proportions go out of round, like this doesn't make any sense. So that again gives confidence to the observation, probably either European or Central Asian, probably R1A is being contributed from Indian population. So talking about Jammu and Kashmir, this was, you know, like that, this was data I have shown you, that one was done in 2009. I'm presently working in medical genetics, but by interest didn't, you know, like go. I still wanted to explore it more. So I collect, this is something peculiar about Jammu and Kashmir is, it's a Himalayan region. There are like pockets, I will call it geographically isolated pockets. Present, like with the recent scenarios into picture, I'll feel like probably, and the over the period, like some recent thousands of years, probably what has been happening is maybe invasions and all, probably the original inhabitants probably had been, you know, migrated to, I'll put it like relatively extreme locations to keep themselves safer. So my idea is to have an overview of like what had been there, remained there in the past. Probably we should be able, we would be required to access these samples and study these samples. So that this is my newer hypothesis. Okay, I'll just share one of the example to substantiate what I am saying is. So what we did is we collected some 90 samples, unrelated, from different groups, from the region itself, and then we picked mitochondrial DNA. And what we had seen so far is mitochondrial DNA is relatively conserved when we look into broader, you know, lineages. We did complete mitochondrial sequencing, and then, you know, like assigned them lineages and all. So what we see here is like we could find different mitochondrial groups belonging to M, U, H, and then there are few more like which are so-called Central Asian and European mitochondrial lineages, that means maternal lineages, but the major chunk is contributed by already known maternal lineages. I'll come to this specific point later on, probably in the next slide itself. So what is the idea here is, what did we find here is, if you see this one, so this typical picture represents glacial age. Glacial age means we correlated with ice age. So that means we see these spikes represents that weather is not, you know, like the conditions of the inhabitants conditions are not good, and then this you know, like period over here which goes after some 10,000 years, we'll see that okay, conditions across the globe are like they are relatively consistent, not some ice age of kind of thing is, you know, like happening. That means these are inhabitable places, times, and probably this is the region human population, like any other population in the biology, if you go by natural methods, like any other populations, human populations expanded in this time itself, maybe starting or maybe numbered from some thousands or hundreds to no billions and across the globe. And like any other species, nature and the environment is favoring it, fine. So this region here, this shows different climatic conditions which are towards stability at this point of time. We call it Bayesian skyline plot. I won't be going into technical details, so I'll tell you what does this typical, you know, like this one and this one represent. This point here, this shows branching and branching and branching, which tells about that, okay, higher expansion is taking place. Higher the branching out, higher expansion is taking place. And this one specifically here tells you that over the period of time, how this expansion is going. So that means what we could see here is, and we will try to correlate all these together, specifically these two. What we'll try to see is that, and I'm just talking about in terms of these mitochondrial DNAs and from this Jammu and Kashmir itself. What we will see, that this is a continuous expansion. That means mitochondrial DNA in this region is continuously expanding in this period, which is some 40,000, 50,000 years ago. Then somewhat it goes stable, and then again expansion takes place in some, I think 15,000 to 8,000 YBP. Again, it is based on this molecular clock, which is the mitochondrial clock. The range is 14,000 to 8,000 base year before present, and after that again it goes towards, you know, like stability. So what does it mean? It means mitochondria's despite we could see some so-called, you know, European mitochondrial lineages, but those existed in this region 8,000 prior to, you know, like 8,000 years itself. Because this one is the lowest confidence interval, that is lowest range to which you can, 8,000 years. Okay, so we published it in this one, and for quite a time this remained some top 10 in genetics and heredity, and this paper remained in there. So this was one part of the story. We had mitochondrial VSAR diversity, but it gave us an indication that maternal lineages in the region were to the lowest level if we go to 8,000 years. We wanted to look into what is the scenario with the Y chromosomes. Again, we specifically restricted ourselves. So we genotyped, we collected some 300 samples from this region, Jammu and Kashmir itself, and we genotyped these for these Y chromosomal markers. And you will notice that this R specifically, and then if we break it down to this typical group, M417, probably which represents, presently which represents R1A. So that constitutes around 24, that means 25% of the population. This is the paper from like Ganeshwar already discussed about is. So these are, this recently these M17 was the marker to which I was restricted. I was, you know, like that was the last marker at that time in 2009 when, you know, I published that story. And after that we have, these are the all new markers. This lineage Z280, this is European, and Z93, this is Asian and maybe I think Indian region. I'll draw your attention one more time here. Is, you will note here itself that Indian region has high, relatively more diversity than, you know, like this Z260, if you just simply this binary markers. And no, idea is expanding all these markers, studying all these markers in, you know, targeting all these groups to see like whether we are going to see again this diverse scenario or it will end up something like this. So that will give us a better picture again, like with the newer data set, substantiating that probably over this period of these 2 days I had been listening to excellent talks, and I'll feel like this way. What's happening so far is all this work has been done in silos, means alag compartments. Probably what we had heard about over this period of these 2 days, it requires to be, you know, like put together as a comprehensive. Probably that will give a better answer to whatever question is about this RNA invasion. So this is the summary, and with it I'll conclude my talk, that we have a higher diversity, but Indian populations are closely related. There is no bigger contribution from any of the group, you know, like which contributed to the level that everything changed all of a sudden. And both paternal and maternal gene pool, you know, like gives confidence to these findings. So with it, I'll conclude. Thank you.